Welcome. By now, I think we agree that the tidyverse is something worthwhile looking further into. And that is exactly what we're going to do now. To start, let's have a closer look to the philosophy of the tidyverse. So the first thing that you will notice, or the first and foremost thing that is important, is that the concept of data frame still exists, but we will call it differently. Instead of using data frames, we will use tibbles. Tibble is just a new name for something new that is supposed to replace the data frame. You see, data frames, they have some disadvantages. When they report on itself, they tend to overrun the screen with way too much information. The way they represent themselves is not always optimal. And there are small other details. So it was worthwhile to replace them. And instead of data frames, we simply use tibbles. That is just a pop-in replacement. If you already knew data frames, you will understand tibbles. If you used to do something with data frames and you're new to tibbles and you do the same thing that you did on a data frame on a tibble, it will work. Because you see, the tibbles, basically they add a class to the object, meaning that if there is a specific function to do something on the tibble, it will take that specific function. If there is none, then it will default to the function that might exist for a data frame. The next thing, we will look into that later, that is the piping command that allows you to pass on data from one line to the other without that passing on being too much visible and coming in the way of reading the code. Quite handy thing, but something to get used to. Another thing is that functions have to be concise, clear, do not too much, do one thing, do that thing well, have no side effects. If you look a little bit further into how to work with R, and especially if you're like me and you come from a background that is rather C++, PHP, and so on, where you have a different implementation of the object-oriented concept, then you will probably have reflexes in R that are not always the most useful ones in R. R is a functional programming language. Embrace that concept as a functional programming language. Use, hence, the S3 classes as much as possible. And only where those really are not enough, move on to S4. And only if you're building a super complex solution that will replace the core way of working in a large corporate, then think about the RC classes. Another thing is that code must be easy to maintain, must be easy to read for humans. So things that could be confusing, like using a dot within a function name, it can be confusing because we also use the dot to separate the object from the function name. Those type of things, better avoid them. So if you're writing functions, use the underscore to separate words. That is probably the core ideas behind the tidyverse. Now, the tidyverse as such doesn't do all those things. It does do some of those. For example, when you load the tidyverse, you will see it will actually load a set of other packages under the hood. You will see when you load tidyverse with the command library tidyverse that you get some feedback about what is happening. And what is happening is it will load ggplot2, it will load tibble, tidyr, readr, per, dplyr, stringr, forcats. These ensemble of packages gives you the core functionality to work with the tidyverse. You see, you have ggplot to plot things. You have tibble, as I said, the drop-in replacement for data frame. You can work with tidy models. You can read in data. you can manipulate data, you can work with strings and with factor objects. That is, by large and far, the core thing that any data scientist at any moment will need. That is what you actually always will need. So it makes sense to load those in by default. It will, of course, also report on potential conflicts or things that you might have been using in the past and might not work anymore. See, the package stats is, for example, one of those packages that is always loaded when you start R. So it is there by default. It's part of the base R functionality. So if you use the command filter, it will automatically use that one. But now you have loaded a tidyverse with this line. And that command filter will now be by default the dplyr command. So these are things to be aware of if you have used one of those functions here in your previous code and now you load the tidyverse, won't work. You will get a weird error message, hard to debug. And so the way to solve it is to replace the line or the keyword filter with stats semicolon semicolon filter. That will force R to look for the function filter within the package stats and not default to the one that sits in dplyr. Right, so we have loaded the tidyverse, we have the base functionality available. So far, so good. Now, let's have a look a little bit deeper under the hood what those different packages do. First of all, you want to start with data that is clean. Data that is organized in such a way that information is in cells and each cell has only one information. Column names should not contain data. Column names should be headers. They should describe what the data is. They should be metadata. They shouldn't be data. And if you get, for example, the typical sales database where you have a different column for each year of the sales, you might want to restructure that. And there are many other ways in which data can be unclean in that logic, or untidy in the vocabulary of the tidyverse. Tidyr will give you the functionality to clean up your data. Once your data is clean, is tidy, it's still not necessarily in a form that you can use it for your model. You want definitely to take variables together, to calculate your new variables. Imagine you have data about current accounts of customers, and you want to build a model to see if people should get a credit or not. Well, the data that you have typically is the balance of the current account for every week, for example. That as such is not very useful. You want to take that information together and build some more meaningful variable that can be used in your model. That meaningful variable could be, has the customer been overdrawn? Has the customer been overdrawn for longer than a week, for longer than a month, for longer than 3 months? And those few variables are much more meaningful than the 100 columns that you have with just the history. dplyr is going to help you out here. Then you need to understand your data better before you start your model. ggplot comes to the rescue and is in some sense a drop-in replacement for the standard plot functionality, but it offers a lot more. It offers in the first place a grammar of graphics, meaning that graphics or plots become an object to which you can add functionality. You can add axes, color schemes, things like that. It is much more modular, much more flexible to work, but it comes at a small learning curve. One of the key things that go wrong when you load in data is, as we explained, that R will make a lot of choices for you that are not necessarily the choices that you ideally want. So we have readR to replace the standard read data functionality of R. And then we have PER. PER is maybe a little bit more abstract, and it was already mentioned in the part where we were talking about object-oriented models in R, because it gives you a lot of functionality to work with those things. Okay. Tibble, we already mentioned also, is the package that will have a drop-in replacement for your data frames. They will report more meaningful on themselves. For example, show the data type, don't plot too many things on the screen and so many things like that. They are the standard data frames to work with if you work with a TidyR. There is a lot of functionality in R to work with strings. The powerful implementation of regular expressions, for example, just one example. Well, all those functions have a little bit difficult naming conventions. Maybe it could be a little bit more efficient and faster. And most importantly, they have to work with the piping command. So the first parameter of the function should always be the data. The output of the function should always be a tibble. Since tibbles were not part of the base R, that is not the case for the base R functions. So we have written all those. Conveniently, if you read in string R, all the functions that you get, or nearly all, start with str underscore. So if you work with, for example, an IDE like RStudio, then that will come in very handy. You don't remember the name of the function, but you know it exists. You start typing str underscore, and you have a list of all the functions that start with str underscore, and you just find the right one. Quite convenient. Categorical variables are, of course, key. And also here we have a drop-in replacement for a standard functionality that will be compatible with the tidyverse as taking data as a first argument. So we can use the piping command and tibbles will be the outcome. So now we understand what the tidyverse is about. Let's have a quick look at just how to work with it. We will come back to it later on different instances, to clean up data, to manipulate data, to visualize data, and so many more things. But one thing that I really want to show right now is how tibbles work, and that's quite easy, but also how the piping command work. And that needs some attention. So let's first start with loading the tidyverse and create a tibble. First we create a vector x, and then we create a tibble with different columns, and we have the sine, the cosine, and the sum of both of those. Just as the function dataframe, you can use the function tibble to create your tibble. And now we have our first tibble. When you ask the thing to report on itself, it will, first of all, never show more than something like 10 lines and summarize for you how much lines there are. So it will not overrun the screen. That's quite handy, so you can always see the headings of what it is printing. It will also tell you what type of information is in your column. Also, that is quite handy. And also on the horizontal dimension, it will not overrun the screen. It will just show what will fit on the screen and then summarize for you what is still left out. All the other things that you were used to do with data frames will still work. For example, plotting will result automatically in such a combination of all possible dependencies of parameters one to the other. So the first column was the x, and then we have the sine of x, the cosine of x, and the sum of sine and cosine. All the rest, I think, is just beautiful and worth to have here. And as I said, this works because it is still a data frame under the hood. So a tibble is in the first place a tibble. As long as it works fine and as long as there is a function available to work with a tibble. But if that would go wrong, if there is no function to handle the specific requirement of a tibble, well, it will simply default to the function for a data frame. It still is a data frame. Right, so now let's have a look at the piping command. And let's just start with another tibble. We already know how to do that. We have a tibble with just some random data 10 random numbers. And then we use a function within to add a few more columns. Those columns, just as in the previous example, depends on the previous one. And that is how we probably used to do that. You see, you have a tuple t. And then what you do, you replace t with something that is based on t. So our variable t will basically be overwritten by the output that is generated of the function within, which in its turn is based on the same variable t. I'm not saying that this is confusing. That is not confusing because that's what we used, isn't it? If you have been programming, then that is what you're absolutely used to. You just have to see what is happening, which things are here, and you see more or less what is happening. However, in the tidyverse, what you can do is using the piping command. You see, in the tidyverse, the output of any of those functions will always be a tuple. It is always the data. The first variable of the function is always the data. So what you can do is pass on the output of the first line simply to the second line. And without repeating it here, that function within will get as the first argument the output of the previous line. I admit that in this example, it doesn't help us a lot. But if you have more lines, it's really nice. And it really helps you to see what is happening, especially because the functions within the tidyverse, they have meaningful names, like filter, select, and so on. It's probably useful to know how it works under the hood. So basically what happens is if you pass something via the piping command to a function, is that that thing that you pass on is put within the brackets of the function as the first argument. And so this line is equivalent with this line. If you have no further arguments like we had here, you do not have to write the round brackets, you can just leave them out. And so this line is doing exactly the same. All those three lines do exactly the same. So that is the standard piping command that you have. That passes on the data, the tuple, from the first line to the second line, and puts it there as the first argument of the function that sits on that second line. And that is, by large and far, what you will find most. That is really very useful, because in data manipulations, data wrangling, so the steps before your making models, that is absolutely what you need. However, it might not always be the meaningful thing to have, or you would be required to just write a little bit more if we would only have that. So what is happening here? We repeat what we had. We have the creation of the column X. We then add a column Y in which we put information based on the first column. We can do that by passing on the data to the next screen. But now we also want that that data is put into this variable here. Well, the thing is that we want to create a model. And we want that variable to be the model. To create a model, you need indeed the data. That's fine. But you also need to be able to address all the columns separately, because you need to write that formula. That is not part of the standard functionality of this thing. In this line, you cannot address the columns of the data frame or the tuple that has been passed on from the line before. You can do that, however, if you use the dollar. And the dollar pipe, that is the one that will basically make all the columns that you have in your data frame available in the next line for directly being addressed. You do need, however, to load the package magritr for that. Another useful thing is that if your last line of your manipulation is something that has no meaningful output. Basically, what we want here is we want t to become the tibble. And we do again the same, we create the tibble, we pass it on to the next line, we add some data to it, and then we want to plot it. So, of course, we can stop here on the second line and then do plot t in the line after. But we can do it in one block. We do, however, again need magritr, which provides the t-pipe, and the t-pipe allows you to pass on to the next line or to the assignment here, not the output of this, but the output of the previous line. So it basically tells you that the output of this thing will not be passed on. So if there is a line after it, then what will happen is that line will get the information from the previous line. And so the outcome of the whole thing is, in this case, the output of the previous line. And that is what is being put in T. Another example would be that you want to create the linear model with LM here. You start with T, you create the linear model, and then you still want to see the summary and the coefficients, but those things do not have to be passed on. So you use twice the T-pipe. And the T-pipe will tell you, well, whatever is done here, it is not part of the outcome of the whole block or will not be passed on to the next line. After that, you could continue with other things. For example, well, we could take one of the coefficients, and if we pass it on with a normal pipe, in that case, that will be that particular coefficient that we want to pass on. That is the core thing of the tidyverse. We will come back later to other things like how to work with strings, with dates, how to clean up data, and all those other things that are extremely important, but there may be a little bit too much for this first video. Thank you for watching.